Hi violin students, in this lesson I'm going to talk about how the bow hold is different in different bow techniques. The bow hold is not a fixed thing, it's moving all the time. However, it doesn't mean that it's relative. It should be functional and it should help you in your playing. So a little warning here, if you might not be playing for so long and your teacher is nagging about that bow hold all the time, then don't go to him or her with this video saying, oh, this woman on YouTube says that the bow hold can be different all the time, so you have to accept my crooked bow hold. Well, a bad bow hold that stops you in your progress and doesn't make all techniques possible, yeah, that's something that can really hold you back, and later on it's very hard to correct it once you are used to it, okay? So there are some standards about the functions of the different fingers. Sometimes beginners say that their very straight and locked pinky is just a Russian bow hold. Well, I had a little rant about that in this video. But let's talk about how your bow hold changes while playing depending on what you play. Well, the first one is, well, maybe obvious to you, but at the tip, your bow hold looks very different. You see? My bow hold is tilted in this way, my pinky might be stretched. And if I'm playing at a frog, then you see that my wrist position and also the way I shape my hand, so the fingers are a bit more curved, it's different than at the tip. Then it depends if I'm playing loud or soft. So when I'm playing forte, then I really want to dig in the string and transfer a lot of weight from my arm through my bow hold into the stick. Well, if I want to play softly, so piano, then I might almost lift the bow a little bit from the string, or just move it from left to right without any weight transfer. Then to smoothen your bow changes and keep the violin and bow resonating, the finger action that you have with regular détaché bowing. I explain a lot more about bowing smoothly in that way in this video. Then when you have fast string crossings like in Bach's E major partita, then your bow hold also changes a lot to facilitate these fast string crossings and also the bow changes at the same time. And to get that speed, it's important that you don't do it with your whole arm, but that you use these subtle movements in your wrist and fingers. I explain all about that in my tutorial about this E major partita that you can find right here. When you break a chord, you get a different sound when you do that with your fingers versus your arm. I've got a lot more strength and control if I break this chord with this movement. And then you see that my bow hold is changing. When you have to land the bow on the string, for example, if you have a series of down bows that have to be on the same part of the bow, you use your wrist and fingers to softly land the bow. If I'm not changing my bow hold here and my bow hold is fixed, I might play a scratch or something. Then when I'm playing son filet, so I want to create a big deep sound, I really want to dig in the string and I might keep my arm a bit higher and use more pronation. So we have supination and pronation. Those are two movements in bowing that you use in most techniques. And if you want to transfer a lot of weight, then you use supination because you transfer it through your index finger into the stick. When you do martelet, you give a little pinch with your index finger. So what you do is that you just move that index finger to give a little pinches. Of course, I'm exaggerating here. That's the same as you do with a solid up bow staccato. So we talked about digging in a bow or catching the string when you want to create a deep sound or you want to create accents, like in Martelet. In spiccato, the opposite happens. Actually, you want the bow to do its job for you, because spiccato is a semi-passive bow technique. So what you do in spiccato is that you're not controlling the bow, but that you're actually releasing the bow a bit, make your fingers softer, and use a little bit more supination, maybe with slightly higher wrist, to allow the bow to bounce. And in spiccato, what I also do is, again, that circular movement that I explained before. That's crucial for spiccato. Otherwise, you get more something like, which has not so much to do with spiccato. In a related bow technique, sautier, which is more passive, you release the bow even more and let the bow do its job for you. A lot of violins even lift their pinky from the bow in sautier to release the bow even more. In up bow and down bow staccato, your bow hold is different, because you will notice that the bow reacts differently whether you're doing your staccato up bow or down bow. If I would use the same bow hold for my down bow staccato as for my up bow staccato, the bow gets out of control. So in up bow staccato, I have some pronation and I give little pinches with my fingers and then mainly the index finger. And when I switch from up bow staccato to down bow staccato, for example, if you have a lot of staccato notes in one row and you choose to break the bow, then I go from this bow hold more to this bow hold. Because if I would use the same bow hold, then I would get... Well, I can't even give the example, because I immediately get stuck because the bow starts bouncing. So, you see, I lose the bow right there. But if I quickly change my bow hold when I moved from up bow staccato to down bow staccato, then I can control the bow. A great example of this is Yasha Heifetz. Then related to that is the flying staccato or the flying spiccato, where you use the natural bounce of your bow. So we combine the staccato with spiccato, actually. And here we have to release the bow and at the same time give those impulses. Now, if you're hearing the names of these bow techniques and you're thinking, Stata, what are you talking about? Then I recommend watching this video in which I explain all 24 violin bow techniques, so 24 different bow strokes, with some great examples to listen to. And now, how we learn these different techniques is to discover some tricks about how to tackle it. Maybe you lift your pinky, or you do a little bit pronation, or you lift your wrist a little bit. And maybe you have a tip from your own progress that for example, your spiccato suddenly clicked when you discovered that you had to move your wrist and fingers in this or that way, or hold your bow in this or that way. So leave a comment with your experience so that underneath this video we can give each other some tips. So I hope you find this nerding about bow technique interesting. If you do, then give this video a like and subscribe for my channel for more violin lessons. If you want to know when the next one is up, then also turn on notifications. Thanks so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next lesson. Bye!